Agentic AI using large language models or generative AI is a powerful architecture, no question. But large language models have well-known issues and constraints. And so if you want to solve complex problems, you're going to want to adopt what's called multi-method agentic AI, which combines large language models with other kinds of proven automation technologies so that you can build more adaptable, more transparent systems that are much more likely to survive regulatory scrutiny. So as we said, large language models are a great tool, right? They're a wonderful tool in your toolbox, but they need to be not the only tool in your toolbox. You need to be able to combine them with things like workflow to manage state or decisions and business rules so that you can give explicit instructions to your agents. You need to be able to provide machine learning and other kinds of analytics so that you can build a robust solution that solves complex problems inside your agentic framework. So to illustrate this, I'm going to pick a complex problem. In this case, how does a bank decide to lend you money? So I have a bank, and it's got money that it wants to lend people. How does it decide that a particular person, that someone I'm going to have borrow money, is a suitable person to lend the money to? So let's think about that in an agentic AI framework. So the customer now doesn't want to use traditional systems anymore. They don't want to sit in front of a long form and fill out all these details. They want to have a conversation. So first and foremost, I'm going to need some kind of chat agent that they can talk to. Now, a chat agent is a classic use case for a large language model. They work great. They're really good at understanding what you're saying and your intent and the voice you use and speak different languages and so on. Now, these are going to be therefore large language model agents. So a chat agent is going to be a large language model agent. And in this particular case, I'm going to assume that I'm going to configure this agent not to try and have a whole conversation with you, but just to try and figure out what it is you're asking. And generally, you're going to either ask a question or you're going to tell the bank you wanted to do something. These are the two things you're likely to do. So this chat agent is going to be prompted, configured, so that it attempts to take your inputs and turn them into something that it can pass on to the bank's agentic AI framework to say, this is what this person wants us to do, or this is the question this person's trying to answer. So let's take this particular person. Now, let's say they want to borrow money, but they want to borrow money for a boat. So what they want to do is they want to buy themselves a nice new boat. And so they have a question, which is, can they borrow money for this boat? So this is a question. So now the chat agent takes their text, which might be misspelled or mistyped or long-winded, and says, oh, this person's asking a question about loan policy. What will we lend money for? And so it's going to pass that on into the system. Now, the next agent in this network needs to decide what to do. And so generally what that means is it's going to look to find another agent that can act for you. So these are often called orchestration agents. So we call this an orchestration agent. It's also going to use a large language model. All the large language models are in green. And that large language model is going to go look in some kind of registry where it's got a list of all the available agents defined so that it can say, okay, go look in the registry, see if you can find an agent that seems to deal with whatever this question is. And then that registry will also have some kind of standard definition for how to talk to these other agents. So now my orchestration agent can take the request about loan policy and say, okay, I need to look in the registry and find an agent that can deal with loan policy. So in this case, it's going to go say, okay, look, there is in fact a loan policy agent. Now, this is another large language model, and this one's using, this is sort of going to be to take the bank's documents and tell you what they say in some more intelligible fashion rather than reading the whole set of documents. And these are generally going to be using what's called Retrieval Augmented Generation, RAG. So I've got lots of documents, and these might be product descriptions, they might be risk policies, they might be marketing materials, all sorts of different things. I've got this large volume of material, all these documents, and I'm going to use it to power an answer to you that's more helpful than just giving you the document itself. Now, these documents in most large systems are going to be stored in some kind of file management system. And that file management system enables me to take different collections of documents, because I'm going to have huge numbers of these documents, potentially, different collections of these documents and vectorize them, put them in a vector database, and deliver them to different agents that are going to use RAG to answer different questions. So I've got one set of documents designed to answer the loan policy question, But I might have several other agents answering different kinds of policy questions that use different subsets of my documents. And all my documents are going to be kept up to date using the sort of normal file management kind of stuff. Documents come in, they get added to the repository, they get updated, they get removed from the repository. And so I've got an automated process that keeps all my policy agents up to date, re-vectorizes the database, resubmits them, retrains them. So that at any given time, I've got a collection of policy agents that can answer policy questions. So now the orchestration agent says, I've got this loan policy question. I've got a loan policy agent. I'll pass the question on. And it gets back an answer, which explains in natural language with references to these documents, how the bank reviews lending money for power boats. And so now I can pass that answer all the way back up my chain and tell the customer. So now I said to the customer, great. Yes, this is our policy. This is when we lend money. This is the kind of boats we lend money on, how much we lend, all those kind of questions. So this is all so far so good. Now, so far, I've only needed to use large language models because I'm really just interacting with the customer, chatting with the customer. But now the customer says, okay, how do I want to apply for this loan. How do I apply for a loan? So now they want to do something. They want us to not just tell them about a loan. They want us to actually sell them a loan. They want, and we want our agents to be able to handle this. We don't want the agents to have to like stop at this point and say, oh, you want us to do something. You have to go talk to somebody. We want our agents to be able to sell on our behalf. We want them to be able to act, do something concrete. In this case, fulfill a loan. Okay, so now this question goes through our chat agent. Again, goes back to the orchestration agent. And the orchestration agent says, okay, I've got a loan application agent. I bet that's what I need. So it goes and finds this loan application agent. Now, the loan app is a more complex agent. So think about loan applications. There's lots of steps, lots of data I have to collect. The likelihood is you're not going to complete it in one sitting. You know, you might have to go look for a document. You might have to go pick up the kids from school. Any number of reasons you might get interrupted. So a loan application agent has got to remember state. It's got to remember how far you got, what the next step is. It's got to understand how all this works. And LLMs generally are not very good at this kind of stuff. So what we're going to use is an agent based on a workflow technology, a workflow platform. Now, workflow platforms are software infrastructure that manages processes, workflows. They typically have a definition of the flow in a visual model like business process model and notation, BPMN, that lays out the steps in the process. And then they have a database where they create an instance every time a customer starts a process so they can keep track of how far each customer has got through the process from start to completion or abandonment. And so they manage this state for us and give us a way, therefore, to know exactly how far you've got and let you restart and re-engage the process. And then they can throw out ones that get too old and all those good things. So now I have an agent, but it's going to be built on a workflow technology. And then almost certainly we're going to use something like MCP, the Model Context Protocol, to expose that workflow technology as an agent so that I can consume it as an agent. So now the orchestration says, okay, what you need to do is start this loan application agent. So it's going to go ahead and start it, and then it's going to respond to whatever the loan application tells it to do next and pass it on to the customer and interact with the customer. Now, so this is our first agent that doesn't need a large language model. This needs a workflow technology. Now, this workflow is going to have a set of steps in it. And one of the first things he's going to want to do is determine if this customer is eligible for a loan. Now, we have obviously we've told the customer what the policy is, but what we haven't done is established that this customer is actually eligible for a loan. We haven't applied the policy to this customer. And this is typically a decision agent. Now, a decision agent is also generally not a good candidate for large language models, because if you're any kind of serious organization, you want to always make decisions consistently, right? You want to apply the same logic to each customer. You don't have to make the same give each customer the same answer, but you have to follow the same logic when you come up with an answer for each customer. You've often got to be transparent about this. You've got to be able to explain it to regulators, to auditors, to people who run the business. And large language models are not good at either of these things. So generally, we're going to use a business rules management system or a decision platform that enables us to manage all the logic behind one of these, and again, deploy it as services that we can wrap in MCP and make available to our agent. So this eligibility agent is going to take a set of data from the workflow and say, given that set of data, is this person eligible or not? So the workflow agent is going to have to access data. Now, it might get that data from the chat conversation you've had with the chat agent and so on, but it may almost certainly have to look up additional data. So it's going to go get customer data, data from your internal systems. And again, that's going to use data technology exposed through MCP, so you have a data agent. So now the loan app goes and gets that data, passes it to the eligibility, and gets a response back. So now I've got a sense that you are, in fact, eligible for this loan. Good news, you're eligible. Chatbot's having a nice conversation with you. And it feels like a natural conversation to the customer, but behind the scenes, it's being managed in a very concrete, reliable way. So now you're eligible, and you say, great. And you keep going through the process. And the loan application process, you know, it might be talking to the orchestration agent, but more likely it's got a concrete definition for all these pieces. And the next piece in the process is going to be to actually decide if it's going to loan you the money or not. The origination decision, as it's called. So, you know, you're eligible for a loan. Now you have to tell me exactly what you want the loan for, and I'll tell you if I'll lend you money and on what terms I'm going to lend you money. Now, that loan decision, one of the critical things it needs to know is, your credit bureau data. It needs to know what asset you want and so on. So there are other data elements. So we might get another data agent to go get your credit bureau data, for instance. We're going to pass all this data to the loan, but we need to know the asset. What are you borrowing money for? What is it you want to buy? And so the orchestration agent needs to find that out. And so it's going to ask the customer, do you have an asset you want to buy? And the customer says, yes, I have this boat. Well, the orchestration agent's now got two choices. It can either ask you to fill in a whole bunch of forms or chat interminably about this boat, but it recognizes that it's got another kind of agent. It's got an ingestion agent. And the document ingestion agent's job is to take a document and turn it into data we can process. And so it says, well, do you have a document describing this boat? And in fact, I do. I have a brochure. And this brochure has a little picture of the boat. So it's got a little picture of the boat. And it's got a bunch of information about the boat, how old the boat is, how big it is, what it weighs. And it's got a sort of handwritten number on it, which is the price the guy at the dealership gave me. And perhaps his business card is stapled to it. So it's got all the information I need. And so the agent says, great, go ahead and take a photo of that, scan it or whatever, and pass it to my document ingestion agent. And now what the document ingestion agent's going to do is it's going to take the requirement. What does the loan application agent need to know about an asset? And then it's going to look at the document and see how much of that information it can find. Now, large language models are tremendously good at this. It doesn't matter if the brochure was printed on a cheap printer and I perhaps pulled it out too fast, so the back page is a bit blurry, and then I've stapled a business card to it and he's handwritten the number to it. It will work through all of that complexity and extract data from it. They're remarkably good at this. So this ingestion agent sucks all the data out of the brochure and says, great, you know, here's what I found. And it passes that on back to the loan application. And that says, okay, that's a complete definition of the asset. I know what kind of boat it is, how old it is, how much it costs, how much it weighs, what size it is. And that was the set of data I needed about the boat. So now I'm good. I've got the credit bureau data from the credit bureau. I've got your bank data from you as a customer. And I've got this brochure about the asset. Now I can go ahead and make a decision for you. So I'm using large language models to find out what you want. I'm using large language models to help me get data in very quickly, but I'm relying on workflow and decision agents and data agents to do the sort of heavy lifting of the decision in the background. There's another use case for large language models, and when I start getting into human interaction again. So let's say that the answer comes back from the loan decision that we're not 100% sure we want to lend you the money. Lots of decision agents are like this. They have a yes, no, maybe kind of cadence. Yes, we will. No, we won't. Maybe we will, but we have to clarify. So the loan application comes back and says, hey, customer, we're going to need you to talk to a customer service rep, someone in our call center, and resolve some inconsistencies or some issues that are in your application. And the customer says, you know, I'm too busy. I gotta go. I'll check back in. And they leave. They leave the chat. They leave the conversation. Now, this is okay, right? Because remember, we're using a stateful loan application. So we know how far they got. We know what the next step is. And so when they come back later and say, hey, I'm back. Can I restart my loan application? The chat can say, okay, they want to restart a loan application. The orchestration agent knows it goes talk to the loan application. And the loan application agent says, yep, I got a loan application process in flight for that customer. Once you've authenticated them, I'll tell you where we got to. And where we got to is they have to talk to the call center. So they say, fine, I'm ready this time. So now we have a call center rep. Now they work for the bank and their job is to resolve whatever this issue was. And two more use cases for large language models occur at this point. The first is what you might call a companion agent. Yeah, we used to call these co-pilots, but obviously Microsoft made that a bit more complicated. So we have these companion agents, and their job is to help this person. And the reason they need one is that by this point, a lot of information about you. There's all your bank records. There's your credit bureau records. There's the application you filed. There's the information about the boat. There's all this information about you and about your application. And this agent needs to be able to quickly answer questions about that information, access information. So it's a classic large language model looking at this collection of information about you, some in documents, some in databases, and making sure it knows how to answer that. It may also refer to some of the policy documents and access the policy agent. So it's got access to the rest of the sort of corpus that you have as a bank. And one of the other large language models it's going to immediately talk to is what we call an explainer agent. So decision agents, one of the reasons we use decision technology to build decision agents is that they are good at explaining, documenting how they made the decision. So unlike a large language model, which can be a bit black box, a decision agent is going to be built on a decision platform that very explicitly records exactly how it came up with the answer it came up with. So in this case, I have a log of exactly why we said maybe to this customer. But it's an internal log. It's designed for the bank to understand why you got a maybe. It's not necessarily going to mean anything to the customer. It might talk about a loan policy that you're in breach of or something, but it's going to use internal terminology for this stuff. So what an explainer does is basically turn that into a natural language explanation for the call center rep. So here's what that log means so that when you talk to the customer, you can explain, the problem here is that your credit bureau says this, but the W-2 you sent us says that. Right? And so they can get a natural language explanation of what the issue is. So they then work with the customer, they're adding new data to the system, they're working with their companion agent, they eventually resolve all of this, and then they don't approve the loan. What they do is they resolve the issue. Once they resolve the issue, they tell the loan application agent, I've resolved the issue, and it retries the decision again. That's how the process is set up. You resolve the issue, I resubmit it to the loan application. This time it says yes, and lo and behold, now you get the money so you can go off and buy your boat.